chapter 5. Okay. See, this is about function. So, actually we know that a program is a set of instructions. Yes or no? This set of instructions, okay, this set of instructions can be many. Okay. The program can be very large. Okay. Now, so this program can be broken into smaller modules. This program can be broken into smaller modules. Those modules are known as methods or functions. Okay. And in Java, all the executable work, okay, executable instructions are mainly given through the methods. Okay, methods are also known as functions. Sometimes they are known as procedures, subprograms, or subroutines. So, actually Java is strictly object oriented. So, any action you want to do, you have to make it in methods. And methods are a part of the class. Methods are the part of the class. Okay. So, what is we have just told that why methods are used. Mainly methods are used for three reasons. One is to cope with a complex problem. That means a complex thing or a big program can be divided into small functions to hide low level details that otherwise. Second one is to hide low level details that otherwise obscure and confuse. Okay. So we don't want to show the low level details to the user. User will simply write the name of the function and his work will be done. He need not see the contents of the method. You as the programmer will give the contents of the method. Okay. Next, another thing, to reuse portions of code, because functions are portion of our code. But one thing is functions can be reused. Okay. So it is just discussed here how it is coping with the complexity. Okay. Divide and conquer rule. Okay. Smaller, actually in Java these are smaller modules, more easily understood task. Okay. More easily understood task. So those are implemented in methods. Hiding details. So we have seen how you can how the user will be only dealing with the method name, not the contents of the method. then reuse, once a method is there, okay, many programs, okay, can also use that method. Even one program can use the method defined in another program. So what do we need for function definition? See, access specifier we need, modifier we need, then return type of the function, then function of the, then function name or name of the function, then some parameters required for the function. Okay. And then body of the function. Body of the function is again starting with curly brackets and ending with curly brackets. Access specifier, as you know, it can be public, protected and private. And if it is not there anything, that is called default. Okay, or it is called friendly. Or it is called friendly. Then you have modifier. Actually, method can have modifier one of these, like final, native, synchronized, transient, volatile, and volatile. Okay. So final, as you know, for a variable it will make the variable constant. You cannot change the value of the variable afterwards. But this with the function, this final will tell that the final method means that the functionality defined inside this very method can never be changed. That means you cannot override this method in the subclass. In the subclass, normally we can override the method. We can write a method with the same name in the subclass. But if a method is final, we cannot do. So the functionality of the method we cannot change. Okay. Now you have return type. Okay, some other modifiers like native, synchronized, transient and volatile. So these are not actually in your course. Okay, now return type. Return type of a method suggests that this method only produce a value that will be used in the calling method. The method which had called it will use that value. Normally we call our method from the main function. So in the main function that value will be used. If you have no value to return to the main method, it can be void. Okay. So you have some examples you can see. INT ABS val and in bracket INT A. Okay. As you see, INT is there at first. So it can return a value. So now it is returning the result of a conditional statement of a ternary conditional statement. Okay. This is producing if A less than, suppose we are giving A value, suppose we are giving five as the input to the method. That means when we call the method, we will write ABS val 5. Now this, with this, it will enter into the method and see if A less than 0, then it will, the result is minus A, otherwise the result is plus A. So here the result will be how much? 5. 5 is not less than 0. So the false one is A, that means not minus A. And see, it is not given here, it is only return type is there. No access specifier, no modifier you are included with the function ABS val. Simply return type is included. That means this access specifier and modifier are optional. We have another method, maximum. It is taking two numbers and the maximum of the two numbers is returned. Next one is 3 star. Just printing 3 star and that's why no value is returned to the main method. So it is written as what? It is written as void. The method is in returning. Yes, yes, it's static, public static. Static is also a modifier. Static is one of the modifiers. You know the use of static. Okay, next. Yes. Static is there, you will make a method, class method. That means you don't need any object to call the method. Next. And say, when you are naming a function, you are giving the name for a function, then you have to see that it is meaningful. Okay. And you may follow the other convention followed by the Java predefined function. Okay. Predefined function follow some method. Means from some rule, though it is not compulsory. Okay, all the predefined methods start with a small letter. Each different word, though it is close to the previous word, but it starts with a capital. Okay. Now, we have just seen, we have just discussed the static. The 3 star method was a static method. It can be used with the class name. Okay, no object is required for calling that method. You can see some example of a such method, SQRT. SQRT method sends a number to the, take the number. So it is used with the class name. Because it is in the math class, math.sqrt. Okay. Math.sqrt. It can take a number. It may be n or it may be x. And it also produces a or returns a value. That is a double value. Okay, so the map here is the class name, and you can imagine that the SQRT method is a static method. Okay, now so we'll now see function, prototype and signature. Actually function prototype means the total heading line, the total heading line of a method. That means suppose ABS value method, the heading line was INT ABS valve bracketed INT A. Okay. So this total line is called the prototype. Maybe in the prototype may not include this argument value, argument variable. You can manage it INT ABS null bracketed only INT. Okay, only INT. Right, because that is the prototype. Actually, in the C language, it is necessary that before defining the function somewhere, it should be written prototype in the very fast of the program, maybe at the beginning or in the main function. Okay, in the C language, you need to write the prototype of the function. Okay. See another example, public static int maximum int a comma int b bracketed, int a comma int b bracketed. So now these are the prototypes. What is the signature? Signature is what is kept inside the bracket. In first function, first method, int a is the signature. The second method, that is maximum method, okay, int a, int b, what is there in the bracket, that is our function signature. So the function signature, actually, why this function based signature is actually very important. Okay. So when you are doing overloading of a method, you actually change, you do not change the function name, and also you do not change, actually it is immaterial for changing the access specifier, modifier or return type. These are no matter. When you are doing function overloading, changing these things does not matter. So what actually matters is, yes, overloading means you are writing the same function. Okay. Suppose FN1 function, and same FN1, you are defining this function, and again in the program, same program, you have another function, FN1 function. Okay. I have told you before also, you can write two, three different functions in the same name in your program. That is our polymorphism. Or not? So, here, when you do this function overloading, the function name and return type can be same, and function name must be same. But this return type it is not important. Actually, important thing is your signature. function signature, okay, among these overloaded functions should be different. How the function signature will be different? You can change the order of arguments. Okay, like suppose you have int a, then string b. You can change to string a and then int b, string b and int a. Then another thing, number of arguments. Somewhere it is one argument, somewhere it is two arguments. Okay, so the function signature will make this possible, function overloading. Now look at this program, demo method. It has a function called demo method test. Demo method test function. It has two variables, x and y, starting with 85 and 26 respectively. Now these two values are sent as what? Call by value to the method. To the method. Method is a demo method dot maximum function. You see, the maximum function is static in this class. So demo method class name is used to call this method. And we are supplying this 85 and 26. And whatever result is producing, we are storing it in another integer variable z. And z is shown. Okay. What this maximum method is producing or returning the maximum of the two numbers. So the result shown at last will be 85. Okay. So here it is giving which are the modifier. Static is also the modifier in the maximum method. Public is one modifier. Access specifier. Public is access specifier. So again it is telling. Yes. Modifier. Okay. Access specifier. See, here again it is telling that how map.sqrt function was used, how the sqrt function was used with the name of the class map class. Now you can see this. Suppose you have a string object s1 and that String class has also number of methods. Some of them may be instance method, some of them may be class methods. The instance methods are called with the object. So you have an object created, s1. Okay. String s1 equal to hello. So you can now call one of the instance method of the string class s1.substring 01. That means has two letters are taken out and stored in another string. So we have seen how the class methods are called, how the instance methods are called. Sqrt was the class method and substring was the instance method. For Sqrt, we need not do any object. But for the substring method, we had to do an object or not. So like that, if you have instance method and class methods, you can also do so. You have other things. Some examples of common examples of instance methods are the system dot out the println method. Okay. See. Actually, we have seen the instance and class method, but some examples of a method that do not produce, do not return any value, that is the print method. System.out.println method. The println method does not produce any output, means it produces output, means it gives some value, shows something, but does not return. Okay, something to store. We don't store. Like a SQLT method gave us something to store. Substring method gave us something so that you can store it and then see it afterwards. But println method does not give anything to store. It does only some action. So naturally, the println method must have void. Okay, the method return type must have been void. So we have seen the use of void. Now, once our program is ready, we call the, and our methods are ready, we call methods. We call our methods. Okay. So that is called function call. Okay. You see this program. Program name is, the class name is path. It has two methods. One is queue, another is fast test. I think the fast test is the main method here. Okay. In the fast test, you have two floor variables. Okay, x equal to 7.5x, y is equal to 0. Now, you are calling the queue function, giving the 7.5 f or x, and you get the result stored in y, and you are then printing the value of y. So look at this, here the float, the n was produced, n was created in the cube method, okay, that is a into a into a, where a is the received argument, a is the what is called formal argument. So 7.5, that is, so you are getting the 7.5 cube. 7.5 into 7.5 into 7.5, so result is n, that is again float, that should be float. So you are returning the result, so that is float. So your cube function should also be float type. Okay, come to the next page. actual and formal parameters. Just now I have told you this in the cube method. In the cube method, the float A argument, okay, is the what is that? Formal argument. Formal parameter. Okay. But what is then the actual parameter? Actual parameter is the when the cube function was called. The cube function was called with the x argument. Yes or no? So x was the actual parameter and a is the formal parameter. So here you can see another example. Malt is the method and it is called with the called here with the malt method is called with length and width as the actual parameter. Okay. And when it is received in x and y, int x and int y, so x, y are called the formal parameters. So we have seen how we pass arguments to the function. The function can function get the argument. Function is called with the actual parameter. Function is called with the actual parameter, and function is the received with the formal parameter. So these arguments, what these arguments can be? These arguments can be primitive data types, can be of primitive data types or reference data types. Okay. Primitive or reference. When these arguments are primitive data types, then it is called call by value. Call by value. When these arguments are reference data types, that means these are the object of a class, then they are called reference, means call by reference. So let us come to the page 119. See this program. Here, again this another cube method is called. You see, cube method is called with a integer variable. That is side is having int value 7. So now cube method is receiving it in A. Okay. So side is the actual parameter and A is the formal parameter. So here side and A both are primitive types. So it is the call by value method. When you are doing call by value method, call by value method or calling a function. Actually the value in the main method or calling method, okay, remains intact. In the called method you may the formal parameter, the formal parameter may be changed itself, but it will not affect the which one? The actual parameter. Okay. look at this program. This is the Kalghal class. It has a Kalghal test. Here the main method is Kalghal test. From here you have orange, an int variable. Orange with the value 10. And that is also shown in this method. Then from this method, the change method. Change method is called. Look at this. Change is a static method, so it can be called directly. Change in bracket orange. So when you are passing orange, you are not passing the actual value itself. Okay, it is the actual parameter. And you are passing the orange value only. So when it is received in the change method in A, A is the change to 20. You see, look at this. Inside the method it is changed to 20. And when it is returned back to the main method, we expect it to be 20. Okay. But it is not like that. You are getting how much? 10. So that means call by reference does not change the value of the actual argument. Okay. Understood? Call by value does not change the actual argument. So it is only the call by reference can change the value of the actual argument. So we'll see call by reference next time.